Hello and welcome to today's MOOC. Today we have a great topic to share with you, which is managing test data with the new test data service. Before we begin, I would like to introduce you to our hosts for this session. My name is Jordan Grantham, and I'm a training consultant here in the Tricentis Academy team. Joining me today is Georg Turner, who is a product manager here at Tricentis.
Thanks for having me here.
Thank you for joining us. Before we start looking at the new test data service, I would like to discuss some general housekeeping rules. Some of you who join our MOOCs on a regular basis will have heard this many times before. But since there are some people joining us for the first time, please allow me to talk about our housekeeping rules. All participants will be muted during the session. As there are hundreds of you currently attending, it would obviously be very confusing if everyone were talking, and that would make the session hard to follow. There is a control panel at the bottom of your screen with apps that you can toggle on and off. Key ones being Q&A, Twitter, Share, and the Media Player. Even though you are all muted, we do encourage you to ask questions during the session. Please use the Q&A box that I have previously mentioned. There will be a Q&A session at the end of the MOOC. Therefore, we will hold the most interesting questions for the Q&A session so that everyone can profit from the answers. We will, however, answer as many questions as possible during the session. But please be aware that only questions related to the current topics will be covered. Please keep in mind that given the number of attendees, we might not be able to answer all of your questions during the session. Lastly, let me state that this session will be recorded and will be shared on our website later this week. So I think that's enough from me. I will now hand over to Georg, who can begin talking with you about the test data service.
Thanks, John. So we have a lot of things to cover today. I hope you're very interested in the way we handle test data at Tricentis. Before we go into the demo, let's talk briefly about what is test data about. So first of all, test data is any kind of information you fed into application being tested. Anything you need in order to run your tests. They can be manually, they can be automated. You need the test data to be able to run your test cases. So it's a very important thing to consider when it comes to testing. Furthermore, you need the right test data. You don't need any kind of test data. You need the right test data to achieve successful and comprehensive test results. This is very important to keep in mind that test data needs to fit to the test cases, the test scenarios you want to test. Test data does not only include happy path scenarios, but you also want to have data which is out of range and even negative data to see how the application or your system under test will behave in situations which are not as common as the normal use cases. Furthermore, the more representative your data is, the more so rough your tests will actually be. So, having the right amount of test data, the right tests for the right test cases is very important. And you need to do that quickly, yeah? Because if you want to build and deploy your applications as fast as possible, you need the test data for your test cases available at the time when you start testing. It doesn't help you if it takes hours or weeks to provision test data when you have to test your application overnight or within a couple of minutes. Having said that, what is test data management for Tricentis DOSCA? First of all, it's all about active test data management, which allows you to track the test data states and link it to test cases. Then it's also about self-service. You create the test data you need. You don't have to ask other departments to provision your test data or to run complicated SQL scripts. You have the possibility to create the data you need. And we have a structured approach using test case design to identify the data you need, which is required to run the test cases. And yeah, the result is, and the consequence of that is, you will be able to run the tests as fast and as repeatable as required. Today, we will not cover all of those topics because this would take hours to talk about. We will cover the part of active test data management, how to track the test data states, and how to do that with the test data service. In specific, we will learn today how to set up the test data management or the test data service for your projects, how to create, find, and update records using the new test data service, how to keep track of the test data changes or states during the lifecycle of the test data, how to configure additional test data repositories, and how to make use of an API to realize your own ideas. So, enough talking. Okay, I will keep on talking, but I will also like to show you something. So let's move on. Okay, I have prepared a second laptop where I would like to show you the setup, how the service is set up. So let me just jump to the laptop. What were the three main reasons for introducing a new way of doing test data management? Perhaps a little bit of a background. The test data management is available since, I think, about 6 years within Tosca, but it reached a certain end of life. And reasons for changing was, first of all, when we built this application, we didn't have so many customers which were globally located. So the test data management as it is of now with the current version, with the previous version, was built for local installations. It didn't perform so well in distributed environments. So it turned out the performance was just not what it should be. That was the first reason for doing that, performance. The second reason was usability. So I did a lot of interviews with customers, with colleagues, might be even with one of the attendees. And it turned out that the usability of the current solution is not as good as it should be. So I was looking into that, how we can improve that. And the third reason was openness. The test data management we have is really good, but we wanted to make it available also to other projects which perhaps are not using Tosca so far in your organization, but even want to make use of the results of test cases with Tosca and share the test data with other projects as well. So first of all, I would like to show you how the test data service is installed. I have already started the Tosca server. So the test data service, or the test data management, the new one, requires a Tosca server installation. This is a way to host the service in the Internet Information Server. And as you can see, we do a couple of prerequisites. And one thing you might notice, if you're familiar with the installation, we add .NET Core capabilities. Why we are doing that? Because the service itself is built in a dialect of .NET called .NET Core, which is a variant of .NET. Built by Microsoft, where we can in theory run services, applications, not only on Windows environments, but also on Linux environments or even on macOS. So the service is built with this implementation in mind so that we can run the service elsewhere as well. So that's why we have to install that on the IIS. On my installation, I did that already, so it doesn't take so long. But just be aware, if you do that on your side, it might require a reboot of the IIS because of a .NET installation, just that you know. So let's wait for the setup screen to show up. The test data service is a very independent component, so we don't need any other component of the Tosca server to be installed. So we will don't use anything else. So let's wait for the selection screen to start. So, almost there, be with me. Okay, we answer a couple of questions. We agree to license agreements. Go ahead. And now we come to the selection of the components. As you can see, I can deselect everything. I don't need to install anything else, no REST API, nothing else needs to be installed, just the test data service. And the configuration is also pretty easy. Yeah? We don't have to configure anything explicitly for the test data service. We just have to type in the usual board configuration for that for the Tosca server. And as you can see, you can choose HTTP or HTTPS depending on your needs. The service is running with both. We check that, and now we start. Yeah. So that's all you need to do, and that's all I wanted to show from the installation. So it's really easy. So let me jump back to my PC. So the installation is running on my other PC, but it will install. As you can see on the Tosca server, we have a new tile called Tosca Test Data Service, and this indicates that the test data service is correctly installed. When you jump to the location of the test data service, which is, in my case, I'm running that on my local machine. In your case, it will be for sure some network address or even a name of the Tosca server, / test data service, you can see what the RESTful, the API is giving me back. The installation always installs already a running repository. We come to the repository and where the data is stored later in my session. But as of now, you can just take a look. This is what you can see when you start up the test data service for the first time. And you can see that the service itself should be empty. Okay, I did some preparation, so I already provided some records in my test data service. But you can see this, the structure itself is very RESTful. So we have JSON objects. Each record can be accessed individually with a really unique ID. This becomes later important when we talk about the API. But don't be so complicated. Let's go back to Tosca. Yeah? So I've already prepared something, but I also want to show you how to make use of the test data service within Tosca, Tricentis Tosca itself. Let me import a subset, the standard subset. So everything you need is now part of the standard subset. Let's just import that one into a different folder. I did that already, but I wanted to show you where you can find that. So in the standard modules section, you have now a new folder called test data management. There you can find the legacy version of the test data management. I don't want to go into that one because that's the way you can interact with an existing test data management, with the old one. And the new modules. Yeah, those are the modules we will talk about and we will use in the following presentation. There are a couple of standard modules, like obviously you can find a record, you can create records, you can update records. Those two I will explain a little bit later, and there's also an expert module available which allows you to interact with the test data service with some functionality which might not be the most common use cases, but still they are very interesting. So let's jump into the test case. Let's start with our first steps. I have a demo folder. I will start here. First of all, I will create test case, we call that MOOC. And the first thing, I want to create a new test data record. So I'm using the, before I do that, let me jump back. I will just delete this folder because otherwise I have so many copies of the same modules in my repository that this doesn't really make much fun to search for the right one. So let's go back to my test case and let me search again. Test data, and the first thing I want to do, I want to create a new test data service. For those of you who are familiar with the current version of the test data management, you might think I forgot something, because the current version of the test data management always starts with a test case design. You might be familiar, you have to publish a schema, you have to first to define a test case design, a test data sheet, define which attributes are used for DDM, and then publish a schema. This is no longer a requirement. In fact, why did we change that? It turned out for a lot of customer during a lot of interviews I had with customers that this is a major roadblock for users to use the test data management, because each time they have to change and add an attribute or to perhaps rename an attribute, they have to publish a schema again. It's very monolithic. It doesn't have the flexibility we need. So we do no longer require that you first publish a schema to make use of the test data management. So you're really free in using the test data management as it is required by your test situation. So let's just create a first record. Let's say each test data record has a type. You can see that, like, if you're using right now some Excel workbooks with Excel sheets, where you have a sheet for users, a sheet for products, a sheet for, I don't know, for credit cards, whatever. Each record belongs to a certain type. And in this case, let's say our type is, let's call it MOOC again, because we are doing a MOOC, and we store our records now as type MOOC. Yeah, and then can I start typing in what kind of data I would like to have? Let's say I want to have a first name, and in my case, that's John, and last name, Doe. So I can do whatever. I can add any kind of attribute value combination I like in this module, and let's say I will also the state, for example. Let's say the state is new. Yeah, so this is an assumption. I create a record, and I create a record with two values I want to use later on in my test cases or test scenarios, and one state which gives me the information that this is a new record I haven't used so far. Yeah, so let me just show you how the test case looks like, or the step looks like, without having any unused objects, test steps there, test step values there. So let me run the test. It will fail because I forgot something. And I did it on purpose to show you also one thing I really find important for our new test data service. Whenever an error occurs, whenever something is not working as it expected, we try to be very precise what is missing. So in this situation, we miss some information where the test data service is located. Pretty obvious, we need to provide some information of the test data endpoint. For those of you who are familiar with test configuration parameters, it's sometimes, or most of the time, really tedious to find out how they are spelled, which of the characters are uppercase, lowercase. That's also something new we introduced, not only for the test data service, but for something for all of you who are using test configuration parameters. Those are the so-called configurations. So in these configurations, you can define sections. And within the sections, we deliver that one already with your test data service pre-configured. You can define the test configuration parameters upfront. So in this case, you see we need two test configuration parameters for the test data service. One is the endpoint, where is the service located, and with which data test data repository we are talking to. For the first part of the demo, I'm using data because this is the one which is coming with the installation. Yeah? As you can see, this allows me to have various variants for the test data service. So one is the one I'm using right now, the local one. We have also a Tosca server running on a separate machine here in the company, or I was using a test data service with a newer version. So this is the purpose of that. You can define test configuration parameter upfront. You can set them on a central space, and you can use the typical Tosca methods to set viewing and owning rights, to create configuration parameters which are only read-only. Nobody else can change them. Okay, but this is not about the configuration section. This is about the test data service. So I will add the test configuration here. As you can see, they are now configured, and I run my test case again. Let's run it in my sketchbook. Now it will work because I have my configuration set up correctly. And let's see what's going on the server. By the way, you might wonder yourself, what about the UI? Why do I show you JSON files and JSON structure? This is something which is not there yet in this version of the test data service, the new test data management. So that's why I'm now showing you how the test data service or the storage looks like by using the JSON structure you have. But rest assured, we are working on a version for 11.2, which will also release a test data object viewer, which will allow you to have a web application looking into the test data service, the data in the test data service. But for this release, for this version, this is not available yet. But I will show you later on also something what you can do with using the API. And to make my life easier, I have also installed a viewer, JSON viewer, an add-on in Chrome, which allows me to have the JSON in a little bit more structured way. So let's take a look. So as you can see, first we have a new type created, and the new type has those values in it. Yeah, we come to the other things as later on. But that's all you need to do to create records. There's no schema you need to provide. There's nothing you need to do upfront. You can just start using it from the very first moment on. Let me go back. Okay, creating something is perhaps not something you, that's not the only use case. You want to find also a record. So let me jump to the next step. Find and provide record. As I said, we try to be very precise on what you have to provide as parameter to our SCD. So every mandatory field has this asterisk there. So you need to provide at least a type, yeah? At least one thing you need to provide. So you can either enter the values there, or you can use the drop-down box. And as you can see, we populate the values from the already defined types in the test data service. This is to make the life easier for the user. Again, something we try to stick to the paradigm usability, user experience. So we give you the flexibility to create any type you want, but we also let you know which types are already there in the test data service. So this should prevent you from creating types with very similar names, perhaps user and users, or user with an uppercase U and a lowercase U. This should help you to see, okay, we have already something in place. So let's say we are talking to the MOOC. And of course, I can say, let's keep any record. I have only one record, so it's pretty obvious what I would like to do there. But let's say we want to search for a record which has a certain state. And let's say the state is new, because that's the one I have already provided here. So as you can see, I go to the test data service, to the type MOOC, and I search for a record with the state new. Let's do that. Let's do it step by step. That doesn't do so much because I'm just searching for it and don't do anything with it. But let's add some additional steps to my test case. So first of all, I want to make use of the test data. Yeah? And I don't have an application right now, but for the sake of this demo, I want to use the set buffer module. And let's say I want to grab the first name out of the test data service. Yeah? Okay. Yeah, we are using the DD syntax here for doing that. And the DD syntax is the same syntax as you're perhaps used to in the classic legacy DDM. We stick to this one. It's a curly bracket operation, so sometimes you have to remember how to use them. But it lets you easily change from the legacy to the new one. You don't have to change every single test step if you can reuse the DD syntax there. So that's why we kept that one for the time being. But we're also already considering changing the way to work with those expressions in the whole solutions in one of the next releases. This is perhaps a little bit more cumbersome than it should be. So we access the MOOC record and the attribute first and put it in a set buffer. Yeah, and then let's complete the test case. Let's do an update record. And let's say I want to give the MOOC record a new value. Let's say the state is now changed. And instead of having it as new, I say it's now used. Yeah. I used up the record. I can change existing attributes, but I can also add new ones. So let's say this also means that I have now an ID. Let's assume the set buff is more like I create the customers in my CRM system, and let's say the ID is now some value here. Okay, let's run my test. So let me just show what I did. I'm searching for something, I'm using it, and afterwards I am setting the state to a new value, and they would add some attributes there. So let me just run the three steps in the scratchbook. Should be quite fast. You can see the performance is an issue for us, or was an issue for us, is no longer an issue for us. And we really improved on that as well. Okay, let's take a look. Yeah, my record has now a new state, and the ID was added to my test data. That's about active test data management. You can note down the state of your record. So normally you have some lifecycle of your test data. Let's stick to the user example. First of all, you create a user, then you use the user in a certain situation. Let's assume you give them a contract, then it is an insurance. If you're talking about insurance company, insurance contract, and perhaps it reaches a state where you no longer use this record, cannot use this record anymore because it has run through all the end-to-end test cases. And this is how you keep track, or one of the possibilities to keep track on your test data states. Yeah, and you can add attributes as you need them. You don't need to do them upfront. You don't need to know in the very beginning what attributes you need to store in the test data service, in the test data management. You just add the attributes as needed in the different stages of the lifecycle of your test data. This is also the reason why we think that this is a superior idea than to publish a schema and to add attributes to a test case design for some steps in your 20 steps process of your end-to-end test cases. Okay, what happens if I run that same one again? Yeah. Guess what? It will fail. And as you can see, it takes a little bit longer before you get back an result, because the whole test data service is linked to the synchronization settings in DBox. Yeah? So it is waiting for whatever you have set up there. I think in this case it's about 10 seconds to wait for a test data record to become available with the search criteria you have put in. Why don't we fail immediately? The reason for that is, think about distributed execution. You have one execution list creating test records and one execution link using them. And for some reason, the one which is creating it either started a little bit later than the one using that, or takes longer than the one using that. This gives you a chance to synchronize and wait at least the synchronization settings to get new test data. Yeah, that's one reason why you can do that. So in this case, it tells me we didn't find anything in this category or type. And that the reason is obvious, because I searched for something which is new and I don't have a record anymore which is new. And so I used up all my available records in my test data service. Okay, let's create another one. So now I have just two of, sorry, to stay there. I have just two of them. One is used and one is new. Let me show you one thing which might be a case which is perhaps something you might find useful. Let's create another test case. Simple sample, and come to a simple sample. And let me show you something. I can just use that that step, just a set buffer, and paste. Yeah, here we are. So if I don't provide anything, any find operation, that's the way I can access a record in my test data service without having any find operation. What it does, it just assumes that you just grab the first record in available record in the test data service, and that's just the one in the beginning. Yeah, that's a way to have a very simple setup. Normally, you always have search criteria and you always want to search for something before using it, and have some more specific search criteria, but that's also possible, just to make you aware of that. What else? I've prepared a couple of samples, and let's go to that one. So before we had started this session, I've run an equation. Let me show you what I did. I created 100 records in a loop. And that's also something new, perhaps, for you. So as you can see, I just created some random first name, last name, added age between 14 and 15, 14 and 40, and a state. And I did that in a loop. And that's also something perhaps which is new to those of you who are used to the classic or the legacy DDM. You can now reuse the name of the DDS a couple of times, also the object name. You don't have to assure that this name is unique within a test case. This is very useful, especially when you have loops, or if you want to grab more than one record of the same type, to make use of that. Yeah. So, but let's use the records I have created then. Let me show you what I have there. I think you have seen that already when I was showing you the existing one. So you have a couple of records here, which are all some random names. And I don't even know which one is of those is the one I will grab with my first call. And my first call is searching for a user between 18 and 25. Yeah. So let me show you what what you have to do. Yeah. So I'm searching for a user with the state new, because I want to use it later on. And here I can show you how to search for intervals, for example, if you have numeric values. Yeah. In order to do that, of course, you have to provide the name of the attribute. Then, if you want to have comparison other than equal or not equal, you have to set the data type to numeric. Yeah? If you set it to numeric, then here the drop-down box becomes available, and you have a couple of available operators here. In this case, a search for something which is greater than 18 or less or equal than 25. Yeah? Then I note down the returned record, and I update the state used. Let's run that one. And I think if I looked at that correctly, it should grab the second one, so this one, because this is 24, which is exactly in the range of age I was expecting, and it has the state new. Let's do that. Run it Scratchbook. So we should grab the second one. Here we are. Let's see. That's the one with this complicated name. Two something something, 24. And that, if you take a look, that one is not used. Yeah. So that's how you can have a little bit more complicated comparisons. All of those things you put in this search filter are combined with an and. So it's search for a state new and an age greater than 18 and an age less or equal 25. So keep that in mind. It's combined with an and. That's also something we think it's more useful or more easier access than the way it was done before. I think that DQL we were using before is a powerful language, but you have to learn a lot in order to make use of that. This way we make it easier to accessible and make it easier for the users to keep track, to find records in the test data service. Yeah. Okay. What else? One thing I forgot when I did the demo to explain something to you, which is what if you don't want to use a different name than the type name? Sometimes you perhaps want to create records with want to have more than one record of the same type. Let's do that. Oh, let's do something else. Let's copy that one. Don't have to provide so many things. Okay, so let's provide a name there. So that's why we have this Elias name here. So you can give your record a specific name. So in my case, I say it's not MOOC, so it's person. Yeah, so I've named the record person now, and I can use that one here as well. So instead of MOOC, which is not what I want to use, I use person. And later on, I give it a new state. Yeah. So perhaps I should have started from scratch because now I have to type in everything again and again. And let's give it a new state. Okay, new state is something, some state, and the ID is also something else. So I can give that a name. Yeah. So that way I can have more than one record at the same test data. The same test case, and so something like that is then possible. I have a person too, yeah, and yeah, da kann I can see here and use this person too in the second. Last, okay, let's see. That's not something you normally will do, but it should give you an idea of what's going on here. Okay, I hope I have enough records, but I think I should have. I think I've created enough. Let's see. Obviously not. I only have one record in this case. Let's see what kind of error message we get. When it takes so long, that's normally, I forgot that I had to add more than one record here. Let's go back to my test case and copy that one. And so, and put it on the right place in my steps and give it a different. So let's see. I should have enough possibilities there. Yeah. And here we are. Didn't I do the second one? Perhaps I forgot. Ah, okay. I changed it in the wrong place. Sorry, let's do it again. My fault. I looked at the wrong test case. So here we are. So one more. Okay. Yeah. So I was able to use two different records from the same type. One word of are the records locked and how the locking is working. So in the background, we make sure that as long as you are working with a test data record, it is always for you exclusively. What does this mean? So each time you access a record in the test data service, it's locked by the test step or by the test case. So make sure that nobody else, no other test case gets the same record. Why is this important? Consider again, if you have some distributed execution, or even if you have more than one machine, hopefully running Tosca, you want to make sure that not two test cases get the same record at the same time. And let's assume you're great users. The first test case gets the same record as the second test case. The second test case will fail because the user is already created and you're in a big trouble and you don't know how to synchronize and how to make that really working. In order to prevent that, we always lock the test case, the record during a test case. It's returned automatically. You don't have to do anything at the end the test case. Yeah, so if the test case is ending, we release the lock and give the record back for further users. That's handled via this this flag here. I haven't explained that yet. So this flag which tells me if the record is currently in use or not in use. This is nothing new for those of you who have already worked with DDM previously. What's new is that we also return the test record, when the test case is failing. The reason for that is we have a lot of customers which have complained that we do not unlock the records, even if and it caused a lot of problems for them. So the records are already, they're also returned if the test case is failing. And we also return them in loops. So that's why things like, let's go back to an example I have here. That's why things like this loop is working, where we loop through a number of test cases, a number of records in my test data service, do something with it, set a new state and do that 10 times in this loop. This is important. I think there were a lot of, it was not easy to make such constructs working in the old DDM, because this naming you have had to be unique in my whole test case. Yeah? So that one is just working out of the box. Okay, what else? What else can you do? Of course, you can also find records using wildcards or the regular expressions. Wildcard is only an easier way to do that. So if you want to search, for example, for a user in my my data storage which starts with an A, you can use it, do it like that. Let's see if I have one. I haven't checked before that. I should have done that because it was randomly created. So there's a chance I won't find anything. The chance was two. I don't have any user with an E in the beginning, but I have a user with a G in the beginning. I will use that one instead. Yeah, that's the problem if you create something with random names. So there's a chance that it doesn't have this name in front. So let's say with a G in the beginning. Let's run it again. And now I should find this one. As you can see, it was working. Yeah, so you can use also wildcards. We covered numbers, we covered regular expressions. What about dates? Dates is a little bit more tricky because there are so many ways to specify date in all over the world. So we in the Dach region have a certain way, in UK have a different way, in US you have another way to specify date. So date is not a date in all, or cannot, it's not the same in all locations. So in order to be able to know that the attribute is a date, we have to tell the test data server that this is a date. Yeah, so I have here a sample, I call that date sample. So in this case, this is one of the few cases where you have to tell to integration procedure already which data type you have. Normally it's enough to have strings, but if you wanna identify that later and I use that one as a search field, you need to tell the test data service that this is a date. Yeah, let's just run that one. Okay, let's just run that one and let's see what's happening. I'm creating a new type, so it's called date sample, and I store one record there, and as you can see, it's about date of birth, and in this case, okay, here we are. In this case, I set it to at least 30 years, so it's set to this value. Yeah. Okay. And we store the date in a common format, so that allows us later on to compare or to use date comparison operators to do that. So we okay. Let's go back to my test case. What would be the next step? The next step would be I search for some customer user which is at least which is not older than 30 years. Yeah. In this case, somebody who is less or equal than 30 years. Yeah. Again, you need to tell that it is a date, otherwise we interpret everything as a string and that one would not work. But this one is just working. Let me just grab those two and let's run that one. And here we are. So we got the record back. You might wonder yourself, okay, what if I want to add not only date but also time to that value there, because I need to provide some timestamp, or it's interesting to add our minute information there. What we take under account by doing that is specifying the settings. So in the settings dialog, you find the place. And it's just using the normal dbox temporal expressions. And this is the expression we choose to store the date in the test data service. So let's just show you something how you can override that, because perhaps you don't want to use the settings in this to change it for every test case. You can just use a test configuration parameter again. Let's go back to my sample test case and let's say I want to let's create a new one, otherwise it will be a little bit too crowded in this test case, and let's say it's state. And again, my test data, create and provide, and I have a new type, and let's call that up. Let's use MOOC again, but in this case, I want to have a date value in it, and it should be date, yeah? Just to make the simplest example. And as I said, I need to set the data type, let's say date. And in my case, I only want to provide, for example, the year. Yeah? So I can say target date format. Let's see, I think it should be
Sorry. Let's see. Hope this is working. Is it upper lowercase? Let's see. Let's check a little bit before I go back to that. Let me check that one. I copied the wrong value there. Sorry for that. Don't want to be precise in what I'm showing here. It's lowercase y. Okay, it's lowercase y. Y. And let's run that one. I hope I didn't make any mistake here. To do that, data MOOC. So you can see we store only the date, the year format. The rest, it needs to be a valid date, so we add some year and other functions there. So this is a way how you can specify how the data is stored in the test data service. Okay, yeah. What else can I show you? Let me take a look at my things. Yeah, so that we don't run out of time. One thing I didn't mention so far is the other two or three modules we have. One module is we have done the grid, we have done the find and the update, but there's also this move operation. Why should you use that? Let me go back to my test case. Let's create a copy of that one again. I'm lazy, I don't want to specify everything. So instead of using state as a way to specify a record, yeah, we can also use a new type to do that. So instead of setting a new state, for example, let's give that away, we can also use the move statement. Yeah? So this is also a way to keep track on your test data record, yeah, or the state of your test data record. So you can say it from MOOC, it turns over to, let's say, used. Yeah? The alias name for that, I think I'm using MOOC in this whole test case. It's now MOOC. Yeah. So what do I do? I create a record. I even can reduce that one. I don't need the state here anymore. I don't need that one anymore. I grab the first record. I assume that I created a record or created it in my database in my CRM system. I get an ID, but instead of storing it back in the same type, I put it in a used or created or used. Let's say not used, but created in a created type. Yeah. Think about having an Excel sheet where you have in the first sheet available records. Then you do something. You copy and copy or move the used records to a new sheet so that the next step in your test cases on your chain of test cases grabs the record from exactly the right location. That's the second step, the second possibility, another possibility to make use to keep track on the state of your test data. So as you can see, it's not there. It's not in the original column. So you can either use states or process names or whatever you want to use to note down the state there. But you can also use this idea of moving records from one state to another. And it's really moving. It's not copy and paste. It's move. The record is no longer available in the original category or type. It's now in the new type or category. Okay. Yeah, one thing which might be pretty obvious, you can delete records. Yeah, you can also say instead of giving a state no longer in use, you can say, okay, I did all I wanted to do with my record in the end, and let me just let's create another copy. Copy is always good. Let's create another copy. I'm gonna keep the old one. So instead of updating the record, I don't want to use the record anymore. It's the end of life of my test data. So I can say, let's delete it. Yeah, I can delete single records. Yeah, I can delete those with a single record. Okay, F9. Here we are. Sure. Again, a great one. I do something with it, I delete one. That doesn't make really sense. Why should I note something down which I delete afterwards? But I just want to show you what you do with delete. Yeah. Okay, so you can delete. Sometimes you want to do more than delete one element. You can also delete multiple elements. And now we come to the expert module. Yeah, so there's also this expert module available. Let me create another one and show you what you can do with the expert module. Why is it called expert module? Yeah, because you need to know a little bit more than with just the normal ones. So let me show what you can do here. Yeah, of course, all things you can do are available now in this test data task. That's the wrong button. That's the red one. So you can do a create, obvious. You can do a find and update. You can delete one record. You can delete a whole type. So you can delete all records in the type because you don't need them anymore. And you can also have a delete all, where you can remove all records of in your test data repository. That might be very useful when you have to reset for another test run and make sure that you don't have records from the previous one available, because your SOD and your databases were also reset. It doesn't make sense to keep existing records in your database. Yeah. So with that, I delete the whole type, and with that, I delete all. One thing which might be interesting for you is the read-only mode. So what we learned, for example, that some of our users or customers have a use case where they want to share data across multiple test execution, but they don't want to lock this data. So they want to make use of the same records at the same time. That's why we are having introduced this read-only mode. So with that, I just grabbed one record from the user type. Say set buffer, I do something with it. So let's say I say again, just the first type, and it's really read only. Yeah. So I can of course access the data inside the record. So let's say, okay, that's user.first, sorry, the other way around, user.first. Okay, almost. If I now just hit the right keys, then it will really work, user.first. So that one will work, but another test case using the very same find statement will get the very same record for its usage. What will not work is updating the record. Why? Because it's read only. So if I now try to update the record and say, okay, in my case I wanna give them, let's say it's user, I think it was, I'd give it a new value, I will get an error. Yeah? And it will tell me, no, you're not allowed to do that because your record is read-only. Yeah? So it's really read-only. We don't lie to you. We make sure that you're not only allowed to change a record if you have exclusive right to do that. Okay, that's for the use case when you have perhaps environmental data, you want to store some dynamic endpoints, or you have created some credit cards you can reuse in various test scenarios. Okay, let's check. Okay, where is everything stored? Yeah. One thing we noticed when we interviewed customers and colleagues, getting a database up and running at the customer side is a long-term project. So it takes days or even weeks to get a new database provisioned for the test data management, the legacy one. This was one of the reasons, by the way, why we introduced last year a mode where the test data management can be part of the repository itself. So we wanted to keep it simple for you. So the test data management doesn't require any cooperation, anything from any database administrator, any IT department. It is self-serviced. So everything which you can see is stored on the server itself. So we have two ways to store the repository or the data in the repository. One is file-based. That's the default value. We're using for that a database called SQLite. This database is also the same database we are using for the local repository. So we know how it's very easy to use. It's performant enough for our purpose. And it can keep all the data you want to keep in for the test data easily. Yeah. So this is one option. The second option is in memory. In memory means you don't have any file on the file system. Everything is stored in on the file server, on the IIS, in memory of the IIS. This can be an option. Yeah, and rest assured the data in the repository there is stored for as long as the IIS is running. And this can be an option for you if you have sensitive data, if you don't want to share, you don't want to keep anything on your file system, you can just use DDB, the member variant. How do you create new, configure new repositories? That's the only thing that we don't have so as such a good UI at the moment. As you have seen, we don't have a UI at the moment, so you have to use an API for that. And I want to show you how to do that. But before I do that, I want to also give you an information how to access the API I was talking about. So the installation comes with something called Swagger. Swagger is a very handy way to document an API. And there you can see we have a couple of endpoints available. One of those endpoints will be the configuration, but first I want to show you that everything you have seen there, you can also use via a call over this API. So you can, for example, say, okay, I want to get back my MOOC. I want to get back one. I can even send it a filter, but I don't do that any at the time being as a data. Yeah, that's how you can create. Oh, did I do something wrong? No, it's that response body is that one. Yeah, that's what you got back by that request. I did something wrong. Something wrong. Data. Response messages. No, it is response body. Yeah, can get back the data with the API. I can say, okay, let's do a limit with 5. I get back 5 records in my data storage. Yeah. So that's the way you can try out the API. And since we don't want you to hack in some configuration files, I show you where this is stored anyhow. You can we have also provide a configuration endpoint. I know you don't want to use an API for that. You want to have an UI for that. We are working on that. But this is a way how you can do that. So that's the only thing which it might be a little bit more tricky to do using the configuration endpoint to configure new test data service. Unfortunately, we're running a little bit out of time. I get waving hands that I should stop now. I just want to point you to a knowledge base article where I noted down what you have to do in order to create new repositories. So you find that in our community and you can see how to configure new repositories there, what you have to do in order to do that either manually by adding something in a config file or via the API. But that's all I can share today. So let me go back to my presentation. Now I think we have a couple of questions from the audience, hopefully.
Super. Thank you very much, Georg. Thank you for the very thorough presentation of the new test data service. You're correct. We will now have a few minutes to answer a few of your questions that we kept back. So really good question here. Is there a migration available from the current TDM to the new one?
At the moment, there's no automatic migration available. So you can do all what you have seen just manually. Both can live side by side, so you can use the new DDS and the TDM together. But however, we plan, of course, to provide one as soon as we reach the function completeness. So providing a UI for that is one of the prerequisites before we can do the migration. Yeah.
Next question. Next one we have here. My company is not a big fan of IIS. What other options are available?
That's also a very, very good question. So currently we provide the DDS as part of the Tosco server installation. And there the option to install the Tosco server is IIS. However, as I stated already, we have implemented the service in a way that will allow us to run it also not in Windows environment. In fact, just to give you an idea about that, I even tried it out by myself and built a Linux Docker hosting DDS. Docker container is a very handy tool to provide services or tools or installations. This is not an official supported installation, but it shall give you an idea where I want to develop the test data service. Regardless where it is running, how you host it, it shall always provide you with the correct versions, with the correct things to do. Yeah, that's very important for us. Yeah.
Okay, final question then. This user says, if I understood it correctly, you only support in-memory and SQLite for the data. I am not sure if we can use those two options. Are you planning to support other databases like SQL Server?
Yeah, you noticed right. At the moment, there are only those two options available. As I stated during the demo, the reasons for that was on one hand that many customers had problems getting additional DDBs provisioned by the DB team. And the second is we don't have a real need for an enterprise-grade DB. Remember the nature of test data, especially when it comes to the synthetic test data. They are only valid for a limited period of time, perhaps days or maximum weeks. You don't need to have a backup strategy for that. You don't need to store millions of records. The most I have ever seen was, I think, 5,000 records. That's enough for running a lot of tests in your environment. So we do not need all those features coming with so-called real DB. Nevertheless, we plan to provide options for all those databases. But also we want to make available to use other type of storages like MongoDB, for example. Yeah, so that's on the roadmap, not there yet. Okay.
Okay, that's about all the questions we have time for. So apologies if we didn't get around to your question. Very quickly then, before we leave you, I would like to remind you of our upcoming MOOC, which will cover how to minimize test data issues with API and OSV. So that one follows on really well from this session. If you have any issues with test data, then those questions should be answered in this session. You can see here, it is in exactly 3 weeks. So on the 16th of May, the next session will be, and again, it will be broadcast in two time zones, between 10 and 11, and between 5:30 and 6:30 in the afternoon. And these are Central European times. As always, you can register on our website, so you can follow the links to the registrations there. If you have any further issues, then please feel free to contact our support team at support@tricentis.com. If you have any training related questions, any questions relating specifically to training, then we're happy to hear from you. Please email us at academy@tricentis.com. As Georg showed you in the session, we have lots of knowledge on our knowledge base and in the online manual. So a great place here to gather some more knowledge or some more information or to look at something in more detail. If you enjoyed this session and would like to look at our previous sessions, here we have the link to view our previous MOOC recordings. So all the previous MOOCs are uploaded here. And likewise, if you would like to view this session again, we will upload this session either this week or in the next few days, and you can watch the session again on demand. We're also on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and YouTube. On YouTube especially, from the Tricentis Academy, there are a series of Tosca in a Heartbeat videos. These are short videos of 2 to 3 minutes where we quickly cover a particular functionality of Tosca. So be sure to check those out. Finally, thank you very much for joining us. Thank you, Georg, for joining us, and goodbye.
Thanks all, and stay tuned for the new test data service. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.